So today we are going to have around 60 image-based questions from surgery. So let us discuss those questions one by one. So first I'm going to take the section A, general part. From the general part onwards, we will start the question. So first question, after removing the pack from the suture, the material coils back badly. The material is getting back coiled badly. And it was as it was there in the suture bag. For example, when you take the suture material, it is getting coiled. What do you think? Why material is properties made up of? What material will have this property? What is the name of this property? Chandya is perfect. What answer is correct? It is proline. What do you think this property is known as? What is the name of this property? So please don't forget, this is pakka proline material. This is proline suture. Proline suture has a classical property of coiling. Coiling back to its original shape, and that original shape is known as memory. That is known as memory. In your exam, you can get a direct one-liner like memory is a property of which suture material? It is proline. It is a proline. You can see typical proline is blue in color. I'm going to explain you certain basics of suture material alone. But suture material is a very basic. You should understand A to Z about the suture material. Please be thorough with the suture materials. Okay, don't make any mistake in suture material related topics. So now let me discuss you about the sutures. So sutures. So you can divide the sutures into two headings. One division is, I'm going to discuss about the suture materials in depth, because last time itself I couldn't discuss, no, so I thought of discussing this time. So we will divide them into non-absorbable suture. Please remember, we will divide it into non-absorbable suture and absorbable suture. Please don't forget this. We will divide the suture basically into non-absorbable and absorbable. So this classification, what I'm making is very important for your exam. You will get MCQ from this classification alone. Non-absorbable can be divided into natural available material made and synthetic available material made. It is from a natural or from synthetic. Similarly, absorbable is also divided into natural and synthetic. It is also divided into natural and synthetic. Let us first know what are all the materials come under this classification. You have to tell me the answer now. What are all the naturally available non-absorbable materials? Can you tell them one by one? What are all the naturally available non-absorbable materials? Can you tell me? No, non-absorbable. Please remember, see the answer, Hannah James. You're not, catgut is not non-absorbable. It is absorbable, no? So silk, nylon, and one more is there. Steel. You would have seen orthopedicians using steel for putting suture. No? That is also a non-absorbable suture. Silk, nylon, and steel are all naturally available non-absorbable materials. Naturally available non-absorbable materials. So please don't forget the classification. If you know the classification itself, you can answer the MCQ 90% of the time. So please don't forget the classification. Synthetic non-absorbable materials. Let us now go for synthetic non-absorbable materials. That there comes polypropylene. Okay. Polypropylene, polyester. Yes, this is the first slide, Bhuvaneshwar. Bhuvaneshwari, this is the first slide. So polypropylene, polyester. I'm starting my discussion on sutures only. Just now I have started the discussion. I'm classifying the sutures first. Non-absorbable sutures, naturally available are silk, nylon, steel. Synthetic are polypropylene, polyester, polybutyester. So you can see this, you would have heard, especially girls, you would have heard these type of MCQs in practice. Silk sari, nylon sari, polyester sari, polybutyester sari. So please don't forget, these are all saris. These are all the sari material, what we use for sari. So in emergency, that is why you would have seen in movies, the ladies would have been tearing the sari and using it for tying. That is a sari material. So all these are sari materials, okay? Polyester sari, polybutyester sari, silk sari, nylon sari and all. Girls, you may be remembering much better than boys about these points. So coming to the other synthetic non-absorbable materials. What is other synthetic? Dacron. Please don't forget Dacron. Polytetrafluoroethylene. Tetrafluoroethylene. So whatever you are forgetting, please don't forget this classification. This classification is very, very important for your exam. That is why I'm very much concentrating on this classification. So please don't forget the classification. What I'm telling you is very important for your exam. For your exams, this classification is most important. Okay. So synthetic, polypropylene, polyester, polybutyester, dacron, these are synthetic materials. Now coming to naturally available absorbable materials. What are all naturally available absorbable materials? Please tell me now, what are all naturally available absorbable materials? There is only one. What is it? Yes, Hannah James, what you told before is now catgut. Catgut is the only available naturally available material. This can be plain catgut or it can be chromic catgut. Plain or chromic. This is plain or chromic catgut. Okay, this is known as plain catgut or chromic catgut. It is a naturally available material. It is of two types, plain and chromic catgut. Synthetic material. Synthetic materials are the following. You can now tell me that this is usually your exam question. What are all the synthetic absorbable materials? Can you tell me what are all the synthetic absorbable materials? They are? Any idea? Please tell me. Synthetic absorbable materials. That is Vicryl. Vicryl. Very good. Monocryl. So all of you are telling the company names. I am telling you the polyglycolic acid, polyglactic acid, polyglycolic acid, polyglactic acid, polydioxanone and these are all synthetic and polyglycaprone. So these are all names you have to remember. All these are taken from Bailey and Love only. And some of you have mentioned as monocryl. Yes, Navya Reddy has mentioned monocryl. Which is monocryl among these four? So what happens, you know, many times exam students will remember this these names, but they forget the original name. Monocryl is, which is monocryl of these four? Polyglycolic acid, polyglactic acid, polydioxanone, polyglycaprone. Which is known as monocryl means, this is polyglycaprone is known as monocryl. Polyglycaprone is known as monocryl. Polyglycaprone is other name, monocryl. And Vicryl is polyglactic acid. Vicryl is polyglactic acid. So please don't forget this classification. Very, very important for your exams. So this first point you should remember for your exam is this classification. Whatever you are remembering or not, you should not forget this classification. I'm telling you again the classification. I'm zooming in. So please don't forget this classification table for your exams. Most important for your exam. Yes, polyglactic acid is Vicryl. Polyglactic acid is Vicryl. Polyglycaprone is monocryl. This is a high yield flowchart in your exam. So please don't forget. You may get your questions because for FMG, they ask you basic question. No? So for your exam, this level is enough. If you know this basic level, that itself is more than enough. I'm going to explain you two sutures in detail, but please remember this classification. I told you easy method to remember, polyester, polybutyester are sari materials. So they are all synthetic, non-absorbable materials. So polypropylene is what we commonly see, and polyester, polybutyester, dacron, polytetrafluoroethylene. Please don't forget these materials. Synthetic, polyglycolic acid, polyglactic acid, polydioxanone, polyglycaprone. So now I'm going to explain you only two suture materials which are high yield for FMG exam. One is proline. I'm going to tell eight difference between these two guys, proline and Vicryl. So please don't forget these two materials. Whatever you forget, don't forget these materials. That is very important for your exam. These are, because these are the two commonly used suture material in our practice. So proline. Proline is non-absorbable synthetic material. Okay, that is the first point. Vicryl is absorbable synthetic material. First point. And what is the company, what is the original chemical name? This is polypropylene. And Vicryl is polyglactic acid. Vicryl is polyglactic acid. Proline is polypropylene. Vicryl is polyglactic acid. Can somebody tell me what is the color of proline? Proline is blue color. Vicryl is violet color. Vicryl is violet color, proline is blue color. And both are, proline is a Proline is a monofilament material. What is this monofilament material? If you see the suture, it is made up of single filament like this. Whereas polylactic acid vicryl is a multifilament material. What is this multifilament means? There are multiple sutures like this making that suture. Multiple filaments like this making this suture. So what is the advantage therefore in monofilament means? Monofilament, less risk of infection. Less risk of infection is seen in mono risk like proline. Whereas vicryl is multifilament, no? Therefore bacteria can multiply in between and it is increased risk of infection. That is increased risk of infection in vicryl. So please don't forget, I'm telling you step by step the points between proline and vicryl. Proline and vicryl, I'm telling you step by step the points. So proline is non-absorbable synthetic polypropylene. It is blue in color. It is monofilament material. Vicryl is absorbable synthetic polylactic acid. It is violet in color and it is made up of multifilament material. So please remember, vicryl will have multiple filaments like this. So there will be more risk of infection. Whereas proline is single filament. There is no risk of infection. Less risk of infection. So now coming to the next point. So proline is having some special property. What is the name of that property means? Please don't forget, that is known as memory. Memory is a special property. And another one property is as poor knotting capacity. It has poor knotting capacity. So when you put the knot, no, the proline will get loosened. That is why we should put 7 knots for proline. We will put 6 to 7 knots for proline. Whereas vicryl will have good knotting property. Good knotting property. So therefore 3 knot is enough for vicryl. 3 to 4 is enough for vicryl. So because it is multifilament, the knotting will be good. Whereas proline will have poor knotting and it is also having the bad property I already told you, recoiling back. When you take the suture out, it will coil back. That is known as memory. That is seen with proline. Okay, that is seen with proline. Now comes the most important part of the exam question. What are all uses of this and what are all uses of this vicryl? So very important uses of proline. Can you tell me some uses of proline suture material? Please tell me some uses of proline suture material. Yes. So please remember, surgery is the only subject you should not mug up. You can mug up any other subject, but only surgery is the subject which is most easiest subject of all subjects. You should never mug up anything. You understand and read. Very simple and logical points are there in surgery. So please don't mug up surgery. So understand practically and then there is no need of even second revision, third revision. You read one time, you do one revision and you can go for exam. So easiest subject to prepare is surgery. Please don't forget. So proline will have poor knotting capacity. And please don't forget, proline is used for hernia repair. Yes, very good, Navya. It is used for vascular repair. Very good. Vascular repair. So please remember few basic points. Then only you will not forget. Hernia mesh is made up of proline. What is the color of hernia mesh? Mesh is white in color, whereas proline is blue in color. Whereas mesh material is white in color. Okay, mesh is white in color. And very important for your exam, you all should know, it is used for abdominal closure. The suture material used for abdominal closure is proline. Abdominal closure is with proline. So some vicryl uses. Now please remember, vicryl is the workshop material. It is known as workhorse or workshop. That is the main suture used in the theater. Without vicryl, we cannot do anything in the theater. Very important. It is used for bile duct anastomosis. It is used for bowel anastomosis. It is used for muscle repair, muscle approximation. Like that, multiple uses are there for vicryl. It can be used for subcuticular also. Though monocryl is best, subcuticular monocryl is best, but vicryl can also be used. Monocryl is best. Vicryl can also be used for subcuticular sutures. So like that, multiple important uses are there. Bile duct, bowel anastomosis, vicryl is very important. Please remember, bowel and bile duct anastomosis are done with vicryl. Please don't forget this basic point. So these are very basic points I have told you. If I am going into depth of suture, suture alone will take around 2 hours to finish for me. So it is very difficult. So I have covered the important MCQ points in these two sutures. Please don't forget these two suture materials. Proline and vicryl. You have any doubt in any specific suture, you can ask me. Any doubt in any suture material, you can ask me. And absorbable sutures, how they are absorbed? I told you, absorbable sutures, Vicryl is absorbed in 60 to 90 days by means of hydrolysis, by a phenomenon of hydrolysis. Catgut is absorbed in 10 days, plain catgut, 10 days. Chromic catgut can take 60 days. They are absorbed by enzymatic degradation. So please don't forget, catgut is absorbed by enzymatic degradation. Vicryl is absorbed by hydrolysis. Very, very important for your exam. So please don't forget these two points. Okay, very important for your exams. Okay, now let me go to the question. Any doubt, you can at any time stop me, okay? Or else I'll keep on moving, because this is a extra session I am putting here. Any doubt, you can always ask me. So the first question answer is, those guys who joined late, this is the only question we have discussed so far. After removing from the pack, the suture material gets coiled back badly. Like there is in the suture pack, like you can see, it is getting coiled like this is proline. Okay, it is proline as answer it. So proline is blue in color. Violet is Vicryl. When you see both suture directly only, you can understand. In this picture, it may look like violet, but it is not violet. It is blue only, dark blue. So this material is, so absorbable suture materials are, if I keep on repeating, it will be difficult, Selvin, because already last time only I am repeating only many. That's why I gave you one simple idea. You guys record and keep these videos. All these videos can be recorded easily. You can record it using a special software known as screen recording software. No, you can record this. Otherwise, it will be difficult for you. So what is this material shown here? So the absorbable materials are, catgut is the only absorbable natural material. This is the only absorbable natural material. So the answer here is, so this material is naturally derived absorbable material. Please remember, this is catgut, naturally derived absorbable material. Please don't forget it. This is naturally derived absorbable material. So it is not synthetic material. Please remember, Harikumar Ashokan has answered as synthetic absorbable. Can somebody tell me where is this catgut suture material derived? Naturally means from which place it is derived naturally. That is another MCQ for FMG. It is naturally derived from, very good, ileum of whom? Very good, sheep. It is derived from sheep's. It is derived from sheep's submucosa. That is perfect. Sheep's small intestine submucosa. It is derived from sheep's small intestine submucosa. That is perfect answer. And it is preserved in isopropyl alcohol is another important MCQ. Very good, Narendra Gopi Shetty. That's perfect. It is preserved in isopropyl alcohol. Okay. Go to the next question now. So this is another important basic question for your exams. You should never make mistake in these type of questions. I want you to remember this exam question. What is the name of the blade among the three? I have put all the three blades so that I can explain the other blades. What is the topmost blade known as? Very good. Very good. All of you. Perfect. So this is a Lovan blade. Lovan blade. Very nice. So what is the use of this Lovan blade? This Lovan blade is used for stab. It is used for stab. It is used for IND, incision and drainage, and for stab incisions. If you want to open the hydrocele, we stab it. Incision and drainage is the main use. The second blade is, what is the second blade? The second one is, what is the second one? What is this? It is 15 size blade, which is used for small incision like parotid, thyroid. Yes, very good, Chandya. So small incisions, we use this 15 size blade. And 22 size blade is used for bigger incision. This is a large blade. For large incisions, we use this 22 size blade. So 22 size blade is for making long incisions. So this is 11, 15, 22. Yes, like abdominal incision, we use 22. So 11, 15, 22 are the three blades mentioned in this. Please don't forget these images. So can you tell me what is the name of the incision shown here? What is the name of the incision shown here? I hope you can understand the incision here. This is the incision. Yes, very good. What is this incision? I'm going to explain you the four incisions now. The incision here is Cocker. Please understand, this is Cocker incision. I'm going to show you all the abdominal incisions now. But please remember, this is Cocker incision, not Rutherford. It is Cocker. Okay. Now I'm going to show you draw you the incisions used in surgery. The incisions used in surgery, I'm going to show you now. So now let us see the incision. I'm going to draw the abdomen. I'm drawing the abdomen here so that you can understand the various incision I'm going to make on the abdomen wall. So the first incision, please understand, I'm going to make the first incision. So this is Cocker's incision. As somebody told, some of you told, this is Cocker's subcostal incision. What is the use of this incision? Can you tell me? This is Cocker's subcostal incision for cholecystectomy operation. For gallbladder operation, we use this Cocker's subcostal incision. Okay, please don't forget this. And this is one another incision in which both side we make a subcostal like this. Bilaterally, it is extending like this. What is known as, what is the name of this incision? It is known as chevron. Very good, Jayashri. You are correct. It is gallbladder. So this is chevron incision. Chevron. Chevron is for liver surgery. Sorry, chevron is for pancreatic surgeries. Pancreas operations, we use chevron. And this is midline incision. Please don't forget, this is midline incision. This is paramedian incision. This is paramedian incision. This is midline. So this is paramedian incision. Okay, please don't forget the way I'm drawing. And this is a transverse incision to enter the abdomen, usually used in pediatric patients. So this is transverse abdominal incisions. So midline, transverse, paramedian, all these are incisions to enter into the abdomen. So midline is most commonly used incision now to enter the abdomen. So transverse incision is used in pediatric only. Okay, so now coming down, this is what we say as fan and steel incision. You would have seen this incision in cesarean sections and hysterectomy. This is fan and steel incision. Fan and steel incision. And what is this? This is umbilicus and this is anterior superior iliac spine. This is umbilicus. This is anterior superior iliac spine. And this is the place we make an incision like this. What is the name of this incision? This is done for appendicectomy operation. What is the name? That is known as gridiron incision. Gridiron in the McBurney point. The name is not McBurney incision. It is done in the McBurney point. The name of the incision is MacArthur incision. The point is McBurney. We are not naming the incision as McBurney. So the point we put the incision is MacArthur incision. And if you make it horizontally like this, it is known as Lane's incision. If you make horizontally like this, it is known as Lane's incision. So gridiron and Lane's are the two incisions we make. Gridiron is like this and Lane's is cosmetic incision, especially we use in females. Lane's is cosmetic incision. And I hope some of you thought it is Rutherford. No, what is it? This question can come for you. Rutherford is not a skin incision. Whatever I told you so far, all are skin incision. But Rutherford is not skin incision. It is a muscle cutting incision. Please don't forget, this question is repeat MCQ for FMG. So Rutherford incision is muscle cutting incision. Rutherford Morrison incision, that is known as Rutherford Morrison incision, is a muscle cutting incision. Wherever you cut the muscle, it is known as Rutherford Morrison. So please don't forget all these named incisions in the abdomen. These are all named incisions in abdomen. So MacArthur is for appendicectomy. Lane's is also for appendicectomy. MacArthur and Lane's are for appendicectomy. Please don't forget those two incisions for your exams. Okay. So these are all some named incisions I want you to remember. Let me keep on moving. So any doubt you can post it regarding to incision. So these are all named incision and you can this you want to zoom out or zoom in. This is the incision. Are you seeing the full page? Yes, this is it. You can take a screenshot. This is a named incisions in surgery. Gridiron, Lane's incision, subcostal incision, all these are named incisions. Okay, please remember these incisions. So in this, the only MCQ point I want you to remember is Rutherford Morrison is a muscle cutting incision. Please don't forget that point. Okay. I am trying to record it. If possible, I will share with you the recorded video, or you can possible if you can also record yourself. So very, very important question coming up now. This is a definite question for your exams, especially if they want to ask you some tough point. No, this is a very interesting question. Can you see this? Can you see this image? In this image, If you see, this is a large mouth of the bowel. So if you see, one part of the bowel is having a mouth like this, and another bowel is small, like a ileum with a colon, ileocolic anastomosis. If you see, ileum is very small and colon is very big. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to cut this. I'm going to make a cut. I'm going to cut in this. It is not Lambert suture. It is suture is Lambert. This is a, actually this procedure is asking, what is the name of this cut made? What is the name of this cut made? What is the name of this cut made here? What is the name of this cut made? Can you see the cut? This is known as chetal cut. Please don't forget. This is known as chetal cut. This is known as chetal cut. For disproportionate bowel, this is known as chetal cut. If you are Palla Reddy, I will share this with the Shaibas. You can get from Shaibas. He may share you anything, whatever you want. So this is chetal cut. So if there is a disparity of bowel, the smaller bowel, we make it a cut, so that it can get, now the two mouths can get approximated. If you see now, as you cut it, the mouth becomes bigger. As you see in this picture, the mouth becomes bigger. This mouth, no, as you cut it like this, it becomes like this. So you can naturally, you can make it bigger. So for a end-to-end anastomosis, end-to-end anastomosis, for a disparity bowel, we make a cut known as chetal cut. So this is a expected MCQ. Please don't forget this image. Chetal cut procedure. Okay. Yes, next question, sixth question. What type of energy device machine is shown here? Can you tell me what is the name of this energy device machine? Excellent, excellent. So all of you answered correct. So this is a monopolar diathermy. This is a monopolar diathermy. Why I am saying this is monopolar diathermy is because here there is earth plate. Here you can see this is earth plate and this is a monopolar probe. This is a monopolar probe. So that is why I am telling this is a monopolar diathermy. Please understand, monopolar diathermy, practically you should have seen a diathermy machine in operation theater. This is a very basic question. Monopolar diathermy is having earth plate and a probe like this. Can somebody tell me? You can see there are two buttons. No, yellow button is there, blue button is there. What are the uses of these two buttons? Yellow button is for, what is the use of yellow button? Can you tell me the yellow button? Yes, very good. Yellow is for what? Yellow is for cutting. Very good, Ismail. Blue is for coagulation. Okay, very good. Very good, Asin. So cutting is yellow, coagulation is blue. Please don't forget, these are the two buttons we have. Okay, cutting and coagulation done with the yellow and blue. So this is monopolar diathermy. In monopolar diathermy, we use earth plate. If it is a bipolar diathermy, we don't use earth plate. That is the point I want you to remember here. If it is a bipolar diathermy, no need of earth plate. Why should I need an earth plate? If it is a bipolar diathermy, I will draw you the images of how the patient will be lying on the table. I hope you would have seen that image in Bailey and Love, very commonly asked MCQ. So if it is a bipolar diathermy, this is a patient on operating table. This is a patient on operating table. And let us assume this is a, so no, I'm not telling you, discussing the position of the patient. I'm just discussing you the diathermy only. So there is a diathermy machine, which is connected to electricity. Electric current is coming to this machine. From this machine, we pass the current on this patient. We pass the current on this patient. So we, to prevent shock, that current should be connected to a earth plate. When you keep a earth plate, if you pass current on this patient, that will go to the earth plate and the current will be taken back to the machine. So this diathermy is known as monopolar diathermy. What is bipolar diathermy means? Patient lies on a table like this, lies on a table, and I am connecting a diathermy. The current is passing on the patient and the current comes back through the same probe. So this is no earth plate needed. Very good, no earth plate needed. So this is a bipolar diathermy. So which is safer diathermy? Can you tell me which is a safer diathermy among this, monopolar or bipolar? Bipolar is safer diathermy. Monopolar diathermy can cause electrical burns on the patient. Please remember, electrical burn can happen on patient. So bipolar diathermy is safer among these two. Please don't forget this point. Monopolar diathermy causes electrical burns. Bipolar diathermy is safer on the patients. Monopolar diathermy is contraindicated for one important procedure. What is that procedure? That diathermy should not be used for that procedure. Which procedure? You should not use monopolar diathermy. If you use, the organ is gone. Which procedure? Yes, very important basic question. Circumcision and fingertips, we should not use monopolar. Please don't forget. I told you, when you pass the current, it will go to the organ, and from that only it will go. So if you are passing the current on the penis, the current will pass through the penis, and the penile vessels can go for thrombosis and damage, and the penis can go for gangrene. So circumcision, we should not use monopolar diathermy. Fingertips, we cannot use monopolar diathermy. Yes, like epinephrine, it is going to cause here damage of the penile artery. That is why. So not for extremities, we can use in lower limb, but not for tips. End arteries, wherever there is end arteries, for example, in the fingertip, I should not use, because it can, going back, it will damage the small blood vessel. It is not for major vessels. It is only for smaller vessels. It can damage the vessel, and therefore it cannot be used in those cases. So please don't forget this point. Very basic point. You should not forget this. Let us move on to the next question. Such infected sebaceous cyst in the scalp. What is the name of this infected sebaceous cyst? So I think you will be knowing the answer for this. This is a repeat MCQ. Very good, very good. Very good, Vasanta, Akansha, Joshna, everyone. Very good. This is a Cox peculiar tumor. It is an infected sebaceous cyst in the scalp. Okay, it is a infected sebaceous cyst in the scalp. So it looks like a tumor. Therefore, they gave this name known as Cox peculiar tumor. That is answer for this D, Cox peculiar tumor. So please don't forget, these are all high yield image based questions. So now here is a triage. I hope you all would have seen what is triage means, sort out. The meaning of the word triage is sort out. So which case to be taken first? That is the meaning of triage. So in triage, which is the tag applied to a patient with tension pneumothorax? So tension pneumothorax is a very, very important emergency. We have to immediately, within few minutes, we have to put a needle into the chest to drain the gas. So usually we put it in the second intercostal space according to Bailey and Lau. Second intercostal space, it is red only, not yellow memory. So it is red. Actually, it's a important emergency if you're not going to treat patient and die in half an hour. So immediate is red. So please don't forget this order given in your book, in this slide. So red is within half an hour we should treat. Within 30 minutes we have to manage the patient. Example cases are tension pneumothorax is one important case. Pericardial tamponade is another important case. So whichever patient which needs immediate treatment will be given this. So tension pneumothorax, the needle according to Bailey is, so for your exams, please follow Bailey and Lau. It is still second intercostal space, mid clavicular line only. So the latest guideline, ATLS, has changed it into fifth intercostal space, mid axillary line. It is now changed in ATLS 10th edition. But usually the examiners in FMG exam will ask you direct line from Bailey and Lau. So in Bailey and Lau, it is still mentioned second intercostal space, mid clavicular line. You should put a needle thoracocentesis. Okay, so please remember this point. So when they ask you latest protocol, it is mid axillary line, Vasanta. So this is within 30 minutes, we will treat this red. In 2 hours, we have to manage this yellow. Green fellows, we can have not at all urgent. Not at all urgent, they can slowly come and get treated slowly. So not urgent, not emergency. They can slowly, they can get a bus and they can go to hospital. So black, what is black stands for? Can you tell me what is black stands for? Black stands for dead or not only dead, about to die, moribund patient. For example, a patient who is having a brain crushed and brain lying out, still his heart is beating. What is going to do? Nothing. So about to die also will come under black. Even if you shift the hospital, that is no use. So that is also coming under black. Okay, that's good. So identify this hemorrhage. This is 100 times asked image based question for your exams. So this is looking like a biconvex hemorrhage. What is this? So you should never make mistake in these 60 MCQs. That is my point. So this is biconvex hemorrhage, which is EDH. So this is concavo-convex, which is SDH. Subdural hemorrhage will have concavo-convex appearance. EDH will have biconvex appearance. EDH will have biconvex appearance. Okay. So please don't post anything in the question and answer. Please post the points. Rapid revision, I'm going to make it, but I don't think whether it will be possible before August. Actually, the rapid revision is for NEET PG. I will try to, but already there is an old rapid revision available that you can use. Students, you can already use. It is already available in the app. Let me try to make it again. So identify this hemorrhage. The hemorrhage is EDH. Okay, simple question. Please don't mistake. So, can somebody tell me what is the vessel injured in this hemorrhage? What vessel is injured in this hemorrhage? That is a repeat MCQ. What vessel is injured? Very good, Chandya. It is middle meningeal artery. It is middle meningeal. Joshna, Kritika, Subramaniam, Bhuvaneshwar, everyone perfect. It is middle meningeal artery rupture. Don't forget this point. MMA rupture. Excellent. So, you are all thorough with this topic. So, what is this instrument used in neurosurgery? Very simple question. That's great, Ambrose. So, what is this? What is the use of this instrument? This is burr hole making instrument. Very good. So, this is an instrument used for burr hole, drilling machine used for putting a burr hole. Perfect. All of you are correct. So, now comes a very simple question and also high yield MCQ. First of all, come to the diagnosis. A patient in trauma with oxygen saturation 98%. BP and pulse are stable. X-ray is shown here. So, please understand, saturation is 98%. That is a catch point here. What is your diagnosis? Yes, Ismail, perfect. It is flail chest. Very good. That is a flail chest, no doubt. So, everyone will be knowing this is flail chest. So, flail chest is defined by fracture of what? 3 or more ribs. This is from Bailey and Love. Again, wrong in Bailey. 3 or more ribs in 2 or more places. So, Bailey says, 3 or more ribs in 2 or more places. So here some of you are answering as positive pressure ventilation. That is a very old treatment according to old Bailey. Now new Bailey says, if the saturation is good, you just give them analgesics and observation. That is answer. So please don't forget, this is a picture showing you a flail chest. Flail chest patients will have 3 ribs minimum fractured in 2 places according to Bailey and Love. So it is analgesics and observation is enough. If the saturation is falling down, then only we go for positive pressure ventilation. So as of now, it doesn't mean always we should repair the ribs. Many times we need not repair the ribs, but recent concept is we can, after the patient becomes stable, we can open the thorax and we can open the chest and we can repair the ribs. That is also coming up now. As of now, that is not an immediate treatment. Putting a metal plate for a rib is not an immediate treatment. We can do it gradually later. So this is an acute case. No, in acute case, first we give analgesics and we give PPV if oxygen saturation is falling. So oxygen saturation is falling, then only we connect to ventilator. So Dr. C, repair of ribs is done later, not now. In emergency, we don't do it. So this is C. It's an emergency surgical. Correction of rib will not correct the patient, but only presently we have to resuscitate the patient and make him normal. So after 3-4 days or after 1 week also, we can correct the rib fracture. It is not an emergency. Rib fracture is not an emergency. The underlying hypoxia is an emergency. Very good. All of you are correct. This is a Mallinckrodt's catheter. Excellent. Excellent. So it is a Mallinckrodt's catheter, not Foley's catheter. Please observe it very closely. Maithili, please observe it very closely. This is not Foley's catheter. Foley's catheter will be having a balloon to inflate. So this is Mallinckrodt's catheter having a flower-like appearance in the tip. You can see it has a flower-like appearance. So when you stretch it, it will be straight. Once you leave it, it is used for self-retaining purpose. This catheter is used for self-retaining purpose. So self-retaining Mallinckrodt's catheter. Please don't forget, answer here is A, Mallinckrodt's catheter. So these are all very basic retractors which you should not make mistake in your exam. What is the name of this retractor? Can you tell me? What is the name of this retractor? This is Devers. Excellent. This is a Devers retractor. Dever is usually used to retract liver. Remember like that. Dever is used to retract liver because the blade is very soft. So to retract the liver, especially during cholecystectomy and all, we use Devers retractor. Okay. But this Dever should not be... Screen is not visible. Screen is visible or not? Why, Bhagyashri, all of them are answering no. Please see whether it's visible. Some problem for you, I think, Bhagyashri. Please note it. So screen is visible for all. So I got a message from Bhagyashri that the screen is not visible. That's why I'm answering. So what is the name of this retractor? This is Devers retractor. Devers retractor. Please don't forget. This is mainly used for liver. So this is a small blade. When you see the handle with the blade, that shaft, no, very small shaft. This is a typical retractor. What is answer for the 14th question? Very good. All of you are thorough with these retractors. So it is Morris, not Zani. So please remember, this is that is why I have put all the retractors. All the MCQs are retractors. So this is Morris, used to retract the ribs. To retract the ribs are small retraction, we use this Morris retractor. So please don't forget, Deaver has a long blade like this, Morris has a short handle like this. And you can see some of you getting confused with this other retractors. No, these are all, what is the 15th question? Can you tell me what is this? This is Langenbachs. Langenbachs, commonly used retractor. As a surgeon, you should have, sorry, as an MBBS student, you should have touched this retractor 100 times. As an MBBS student, you should have touched this retractor 100 times, because this is usually given to the house surgeons and residents to retract. When the surgeon is doing the surgery, they will give this retractor to you. So this is available in very small various sizes. This is Langenbachs. This is Zerny. Can you note the difference? Langenbach is having a very small shaft, whereas Zerny is having a wide shaft. So don't get confused in this. Sorry, Morris is having a wide shaft. So Morris has a wide one like this, held by a handle like this. Here, Langenbach's, that is not so wide. It will be nearly this much size. That's all. The shape difference is the main one. The shape. So Langenbach's will have very small shaft. So please see this. This is Zerny. This is a high yield MCQ for FMG exams. You should never make mistake. This side will look like Langenbach. Please remember, one side will look like Langenbach, and other side we have a splitted end like this, so that between the two end we can take some sutures. This is typical Zerny. I will send both the PDF of the previous class and this class also to Shaibaz. I have already sent him also. You can get the PDF from him. I have already sent the PDF. Anyhow, I will send him again also. So Zerny retractor. This is Zerny's retractor. Please don't forget, it is having one side shaft like this. Another side will have a shaft like this, splitted shaft. So again, I hope you. What is this forceps? What is this forceps? Where should I post it? Can you tell me? Is it possible to be posted by the Zoom itself? I don't think it is possible to be. I can share this PDF. I don't know how to share this, but I can share this PDF to Shaibaz. You get from his WhatsApp group. In Telegram, shall I put it in our Telegram group? Surgery 6 Telegram group. Okay, you can see in my Telegram group. You can download from my Telegram group. Okay, my Telegram group is TME Surgery 6. I will post both the previous and this one, both thing in this Telegram group today. After the class, you can see that. That is a link I have sent. I have sent the link. So this is a typical Allis tissue forceps used to hold the fascia. Allis tissue forceps is used to hold the fascia. Please don't forget this. And I hope you will be knowing this image. 18th question. I'm just rushing through the images, because these are all need no much explanation. You have to know the pictures. So this is a Babcock's forceps. It is used to hold the bowel. Bowel, appendix and all is held up with this Babcock's. We should not use this Allis to hold the bowel. If you use this Allis to hold the bowel will get tarred. So please don't forget, we should not use this for holding the bowel. We should use it only for fascia and muscle like that only. We use this Allis. This is used for holding the muscle and appendix. So Babcock's. So very simple. This is an instrument used in laparoscopy. If you see, this is having a valve so that we can puncture it into the abdomen and we can put the gas. So arteries we can hold with Babcock's, but there are special forceps are available for arteries, which is not needed for FMG Vasanta. So just remember these two instruments. So this instrument shown here, can somebody tell me what is the name of this instrument? So can you tell me what is the name of this instrument? It is Akansha. You are nearly correct. It is Veery's needle. Veery's needle. Okay, it is known as Veery's needle. It is known as Veery's needle. Please don't forget this. It's known as Veery's needle. It is having a washer. So it's having a valve, not washer. It is having a valve which will help you to enter inside without damaging the bowel. That is, it is a closed technique of insufflating gas. So please remember, this is a closed technique of insufflating gas. Through this place, we insufflate the gas. What is the gas used in laparoscopy? Can you tell me what is the gas used? What is the gas used? Very good, Vasanta. CO2. The pressure we use is up to 10 to 15 millimeters mercury. The pressure used is, all of you excellent, Jayashri, Rajeshwaran, Nannam, Navi, all of you are correct. So it is used as 10 to 15 millimeters mercury. CO2 is used. Okay, CO2 is used. This is a closed technique of laparoscopy. Please don't forget. This is a direct picture from Bailey and Love. I hope you know the answer. What is the name of this robot? What is the name of this robot? Very good, very good. Da Vinci, excellent. All of you are correct. This is a Da Vinci robot. So please don't forget the name of this robotic system. It is Da Vinci robot used for robotic surgeries, and it is available now in many centers. Please don't forget Da Vinci robot. Okay, so that completes the general part. We will go to the next section B, head and neck endocrine and breast surgery. So what is the name of this neck dissection? Can you tell me what is the name of this neck dissection shown here? This picture shown here is a surgery done for oral cancers with neck secondaries. No, we remove all these. I hope you remember on that day we discussed radical neck dissection. Radical neck node dissection. We remove level 1 to 5 nodes. We remove level 1 to 5 level group of nodes. We remove parotid gland, part of the parotid gland. We remove submandibular gland. And along with this, we remove SIS. We remove SIS in radical neck dissection, that is sternocleidomastoid muscle, internal jugular vein, spinal accessory nerve. So please don't forget, in radical neck node dissection, we remove level 1 to 5 nodes in the neck. Along with it, we remove some part of parotid gland and submandibular gland. You can see submandibular gland is removed, parotid gland partly removed, and you can see sternocleidomastoid removed, IJV removed, and only there is carotid artery and vagus nerve remaining there. If you observe closely, you can see the carotid artery and vagus nerve remaining there. And this is radical neck node dissection, not modified radical. Many of you have answered as modified radical. This is not modified radical, it is radical. In which sternocleidomastoid muscle, internal jugular vein, spinal accessory nerve, everything is removed. So therefore, it is modified. It is not modified radical. It is radical neck node dissection. In MR&D, I will be preserving those structures. Please remember, I will preserve these structures. I will preserve these structures. If you are going to answer this, you are going to definitely pass this exam. If this is a direct picture from Alien Love and it is a neat PG question. Very good, Akansha, Ismail. Ismail, it's not correct. Please review your answer. Some of you are answering correctly. Vasanta, please answer. It's not correct. So Joshna, correct. Satya, correct. So some of you have answered correctly. Some of you are not yet correct. But this is a picture. Again, I'm telling you, they will ask you pictures directly from Bailey and Love. So this is a Weber Ferguson incision, not cistrunk. Cistrunk is done here. No. Cistrunk is done for chiroglossal cyst. Many of you have answered as cistrunk. Cistrunk incision is a incision made in the neck like this for a chiroglossal cyst. Can you note this incision? It is made close to the medial canthus of the face like this. It is done for hard palate tumors. This is done for hard palate and maxilla tumors. This is known as Weber-Ferguson incision. Please don't forget, it is known as Weber-Ferguson incision. And this image has come 2 times in NEET PG. So I am expecting this question may come for you also. That is why I have done this. Very good, Akansha. This is used for facio-maxillary. Mainly not for facio, it is for maxilla. The maxilla surgery, you have to do maxillary tumors or for hard palate tumors. We open this like a flap so that I can go inside and I will suture it back. So this is known as Weber-Ferguson incision. Please don't forget this slide. Weber-Ferguson incision. I hope you all can identify what is this. This is a classical disease. Everything I have discussed, all these 60 MCQs I'm discussing today are taken from Bailey and Love. So very good, very good. All of you are answering correctly. So there are 2 points I want to tell you in this. This is a cleft lip with a cleft palate. This is a cleft lip with the cleft palate, and the classification used is Lachal classification. L-A-H-S-H-A-L classification. Lachal. What is this Lachal classification? Now let me discuss a few points about this. This is a very basic topic, so I want you to know what is it. I want you to know what is this. Please remember this. So please don't forget, Lachal. What is this Lachal means? L-A-H-S-H-A-L means L for, see, this is a patient's upper lip. Let us assume this is upper lip. So L stands for this right side upper lip. Right side upper lip. L stands for right side upper lip. So lip, and this is alveolus. This is alveolus. And this is This is alveolus and this is hard palate. This is hard palate and here comes the soft palate. So like this. So S for soft palate. So L for lip, A for alveolus, S for hard palate, S for soft palate. So this is the right side. And coming to this side, this is hard palate, this is alveolus, this is lip. So this is Laschel classification. This is known as Laschel classification. Lip, alveolus, hard palate, soft palate, hard palate, then alveolus, lip. Like that, this is from right side to left side. It explains you what are all the defects. So this is known as Laschel classification. And the most common syndrome associated with this is known as Pierre-Robbins syndrome. Pierre-Robbins syndrome. Pierre-Robbins syndrome is the most commonly associated syndrome in these cases. Okay, Pierre-Robbins syndrome is the Talbot's classification. There are many classifications available, Narendra Gopi said. There are so many classifications there. It is better to know some classification, not no need to know everything. Just remember, this is what is there in Bailey and Love, you remember. This is what there in Bailey and Love. So please remember, Laschel classification can be asked for your exams. And please don't forget, this is a high-yield MCQ for your exam. Especially this Pierre-Robbins sequence. That is why I want you to know that Pierre-Robbins sequence. Please don't forget, Pierre-Robbins sequence can come for your exam. That is a Pierre-Robbins syndrome. Is the most common syndrome associated with this cleft palate. No, Talbot's is not the other name for it. That is another classification. There are so many classifications available. Just remember this Laschel. Okay, Laschel, just remember the name. Name this sign shown here. Name this sign shown here. I hope you would identify this tumor. This is a tumor known as, what is the name of this tumor? This is a carotid body tumor. This is a carotid body tumor. From the image, you can identify this is carotid body tumor. There is a huge tumor sitting at the bifurcation of common carotid artery. This is bifurcation of common carotid artery. There is a tumor located here. This is an internal carotid artery. You can identify from the angio. This is internal carotid artery. This is external carotid artery. So between the two arterial bifurcation, there is a tumor known as carotid body tumor. There is a tumor known as carotid body tumor. Okay, there is a tumor known as carotid body tumor. And please don't forget, this tumor causes splaying of the common, the separation of the common branches. So that is sign known as Lyre sign in angio. That sign is known as Lyre sign in angio. This sign is known as Lyre sign. So please don't forget, these are all very basic questions. Lyre sign. So the latest treatment for this condition is, what is the name? What is the latest treatment for this condition shown here? So what do you think? What do you think here? What do you think this is? This is actually diagnosis is, what is that? This is a diagnosis, cystic hygroma. Many of you are answering not correctly. Many of you are answering a old treatment. This is cystic hygroma, which is a lymphatic sequestration seen in the neck of newborn babies. This is not lymphoma. This is transillumination positive. It will be transillumination positive. It is commonly presenting in newborn babies. So olden treatment was neck dissection and surgical excision. New treatment is injection pisibanil sclerotherapy. Injection pisibanil. We inject this pisibanil into this swelling. We put this pisibanil. That is the latest treatment. So please don't forget, the latest treatment is injection pisibanil. Is the latest treatment. So latest treatment is pisibanil, cystic hygroma, which is highly transillumination, transilluminant positive. Please don't forget this thing. Surgical excision, neck dissection are all old treatment. The question is asking latest treatment. Answer is pisibanil. So I hope you would understand what is this case going to deal with. So you can see here the next picture, image 26. I'm discussing the anatomy here. Scalenus anterior. I hope you are seeing the anatomy here. This is scalenus anterior. This is scalenus medius, and it is inferiorly bounded by first rib. So this is a triangle, scalenus anterior, scalenus medius, first rib. So this triangle is known as scalene triangle. Please don't forget this anatomy MCQ. So this is a scalene triangle. When it gets compressed, when this gets compressed by cervical rib here, presence of cervical rib here, when it is going into the triangle, it will compress the structures. The two structures coming out here are subclavian artery is coming out. I hope you see that in that image, and brachial plexus is coming out in this image. So the question is, in a thoracic outlet syndrome, what are the structures coming out? brachial plexus is coming out and subclavian artery is coming out. In brachial plexus, which trunk is compressed? Very good, Sushant Balaji, Vasanta Jagadishan, both of you are correct. The lower trunk is compressed. What is the root value for lower trunk? This is actually an applied anatomy question. What is the root value? It is C8T1. The root value is C8T1. Please don't forget. So C8T1 is compressed in thoracic outlet syndrome. This TOS means thoracic outlet syndrome. Okay. So this is a typical scalene triangle or thoracic outlet in which, due to cervical rib, the lower trunk is compressed. So this is the same case. You can see this girl is also having a cervical rib. I'm showing you, this is a bony swelling here. You can see the bony swelling here. This is a bony swelling seen in the neck. You can present a cervical rib present as a bony swelling in the posterior neck, posterior to sternocleidomastoid. Inside the scalene triangle, there will be a bony swelling. That bony swelling is what? That is a question asking. That is a cervical rib. And this girl, you can see, because of cervical rib compressing the subclavian artery, she has started getting gangrene of the fingers. Gangrene of fingers. Please don't forget this point. She is getting a gangrene of fingers. What is the name of this test? So the girl is having a compression here and she is doing a test here. As she is turning like this and take a deep breath, the radial artery pulse decreases. What is the name of that test? Please understand, what is the name of that test? Test to detect thoracic outlet obstruction. Test to do detect thoracic outlet syndrome, or the first test I am showing is Adson test. Okay, Adson test. Second test I am going to show you is Roos test. These are the two tests I want you to remember. See, I am showing you the first test. Extend the arm, turn same side, take a deep breath. There will be radial artery pulse decreasing. Roos test is, we ask the patient to keep the hand like this and ask him do like this continuously for 5 minutes. When they are doing like this, they will have pain and they will leave the hand down. That is known as Roos test. So please don't forget Adson and Roos test for your exams. Adson and Roos test, please don't forget for your FMG exams. So this is a question showing you. Yes, we have to do a severe extension like this. We have to do like this deep extension. You have to extend the neck and turn up same side. We have to turn to the same side and take a deep breath. Okay. So this is the test. Now see the picture. Name the test shown here for cervical rib. I have already told you the answer. What is the answer? So please don't forget, this is a typical picture showing you the Adson test. I told you, this test you should remember. So this is an Adson test. You can see the examiner is, what do you infer in this test is, you can see the examiner will be palpating the radial artery. The radial artery dynamicity decreases. The dynamicity of the radial artery will decrease, which is easily palpable, will become less palpable. That is what seen in this test. On turning like this, already narrowed scalene triangle will compress the subclavian artery. Please don't forget. Okay. So yes, this is again a perfect picture taken only there in Bailey and Love, not even subdistant Swartz. Nobody has this picture. And this is the most common site of ectopic salivary tissue. What is it? This is a, yes, what is this on an X-ray? At the angle of mandible, there is a radio lucent shadow-like material seen here. What is the name of this? It is known as ectopic salivary tissue. It is common at the angle of mandible. No need to see the image itself. You can answer it. It is a direct MCQ, Stafney bone cyst. So please don't forget Stafney bone cyst. This is a Stafney bone cyst. Now let me tell you what are all the most common site of some ectopics. So ectopic means not present in its original place. It is present in somewhere abnormally, like ectopic pregnancy, not present in the uterus and present in fallopian tube like that. So most common site of ectopic salivary gland, as you saw in this picture, no, salivary tissue is Stafney bone cyst. Stafney bone cyst, it is at the angle of mandible. That is first question. Ectopic sebaceous tissue, can you tell me where is it present? Ectopic sebaceous tissue is present at lips. What is the name of this disease? It is known as Fardy's disease. Fardy's disease. So ectopics, I am telling you one by one. N by one, what are all the various places of ectopic? ectopic salivary tissue, ectopic sebaceous tissue, ectopic stomach mucosa. Can you tell me where is it seen? Ectopic stomach mucosa, ectopic pancreatic mucosa. Where are these two seen most commonly? Ectopic stomach mucosa is most commonly seen in Meckel's diverticulum. Ectopic pancreatic mucosa is most commonly seen in duodenum. And the FMG question, actually these are all not FMG questions so far I am coming. This is a typical FMG question. What is the most common site of ectopic spleen? Ectopic spleen is most common in splenic hilum. At the hilum of spleen itself, you get ectopic spleen. Please don't forget this. Ectopic spleen is most common in hilum of spleen itself. Another question which can be asked in FMG is ectopic testis. Where is it common? So ectopic testis is superficial inguinal pouch. It is seen in superficial inguinal pouch. Superficial inguinal pouch is ectopic testis. Ectopic spleen is splenic hilum. Ectopic salivary tissue is Stephanie bone cyst. Sebaceous tissue is Fordyce disease. Mucosa, stomach mucosa is Meckel's. So please don't forget these ectopics, most common site of ectopics. All these are very important for exam in surgery. Especially ectopic spleen is a repeat MCQ. Ectopic spleen is seen in splenic hilum. Is seen in splenic hilum. Please don't forget. Sebaceous tissue is usually absent in mucosa and palms and soles. So such tissue present in the lips is known as Fordyce disease. It's known as Fordyce disease. Okay. So that's about these ectopic things. So please don't forget these ectopic things. I'll go to the next question now. So I think this test is for big goiter. I hope you know that. I hope you can understand this. This is for big goiter. Put it there. Thanni etta sir. Name this test for big goiter with retrosternal extension. This is a retrosternal goiter where you are unable to see the lower border. So what we do is we ask the patient to hyperextend the arms and touch the ear. Touch the ear like this. So at that time when you do, there will be puffiness of the face, dilatation of the veins. So this is known as typical Pemberton sign. You should never make mistake in this question at all. This is a typical Pemberton sign. And this question is high yield MCQ for FMG exam. What is the test done for retrosternal goiter extension? So this is Pemberton sign. I hope you understand. I hope that the first question you will answer immediately. This condition is a feature of which disease? This is a condition seen in Graves' disease. Note, this is actually not myxedema. Many of you are answering myxedema. The name of this condition is known as, please remember, the name is pre-tibial myxedema. The guys have named it wrongly. This is seen in Graves' disease. Very good, Anne Maria. It's correct. It is seen in Graves' disease. That is in hyperthyroidism, you get this. It is due to mucopolysaccharide deposition in front of the tibia. Mucopolysaccharide-like deposition in Graves' disease causes this. It is pre-tibial myxedema. Okay, it is known as pre-tibial myxedema. No confusion. Please remember this. I hope you will answer this question on that day itself. I told you this. We had discussed about it. Effanasia of the thyroid gland tumor is shown here, and you are seeing a cell here. I hope you are seeing this cell here. What is the name of this cell? The name of this cell is the nucleus is having no nucleoli inside. This is known as very good orphan Annyi nuclei. Ismail Jayashree, very good. Orphan Annyi nuclei, and I hope you know that it is seen in papillary cancer. So answer here is papillary cancer. Effanasia of the thyroid gland tumor is shown here, and this is papillary cancer of thyroid. It is known as papillary cancer of thyroid. Very good. It is orphan Annyi nuclei. One interesting applied question coming up here. On a fifth post-op day, post-thyroidectomy, you are measuring BP for a patient. Post-total thyroidectomy has been done. You are measuring BP for a patient. At that time, as you are measuring the BP for the patient, please understand the question. At the time you are measuring the BP for the patient, the patient hand is going like this. See me, the hand is, sorry, hand is going like this, like a carpal spasm. The hand is going like this. As you increase the BP, it is going like this. So it is going like this, and the patient, when you touch here, you're having twitching like this. So this is known as, this sign shown here is known as Trousseau sign. Very good, Vasil. Trousseau sign. This sign is Trousseau sign, and it is a sign of loss of blood supply to parathyroid, resulting in hypocalcemia. Loss of blood supply to parathyroid resulting in hypocalcemia is known as Trousseau sign. It is known as Trousseau sign. Please don't forget. Loss of blood supply to parathyroid resulting in hypocalcemia is known as Trousseau sign. Another sign which I am telling you like this, when you tap in front of the ear, you will get a twitching. That sign is known as Chausstuck sign. Very good, Joshna. That is Chausstuck sign. That sign is Chausstuck sign. Very good, Joshna. That's perfect. That sign is Chausstuck sign. So the answer here is A. Answer here is A. So now another important endocrine question. A patient presents with bone pain and fracture, renal stones and psychic features. So the question is direct line from Bailey and Love. The question line is bones, stones, abdominal, groans, psychic moans. This is what Bailey says for a patient who is having a hyperparathyroidism. Hyperparathyroidism patients will get these symptoms, and it is most commonly due to a solitary adenoma. In this picture, you can see there is a parathyroid adenoma inside the chest. So it is due to parathyroid adenoma. It is typically due to parathyroid adenoma. It is present inside the chest. Parathyroid adenoma. So it is known as technetium 99m cystem EB scan. So technetium 99m cystem EB scan. It is known as technetium 99m cystem EB scan, which is used to diagnose the parathyroid adenomas. Especially ectopic parathyroid adenomas can be localized with the help of this. Very good. Most of you have answered it correctly. So Mondor's disease, I hope you know what is this. This is a Mondor's disease. You can feel a cord-like structure on the breast. So this is due to disease related to vein. So it is a superficial vein thrombophlebitis. Superficial vein thrombophlebitis is known as Mondor's disease. Okay. Please don't forget, these are simple questions. You should not make mistake. I hope you can understand what is this investigation. This is an investigation of the breast going on here. There is an investigation of breast going on here. We take two views. One is mammography, craniocaudal view. Please don't forget, we take two views, craniocaudal view, mediolateral oblique view. Two views are taken in this. This is B. Very good. So all of you are correct. So this is a simple question. Mammography of breast. Two views are taken. Craniocaudal, mediolateral oblique. So now 37th question is a simple question, and already I have discussed this. This is a picture showing you an orange skin appearance. This is a typical PUD orange. To my knowledge, you should not make mistakes in this thyroid, breast and all image. You should not make mistake. So PUD orange comes under T4B, skin involvement. Skin involvement. So it is T4B, no mistake, no discussion for this. Already we have discussed this in our previous session. Okay, previous session we have discussed. And this is an excellent question and high yield MCQ for your exam. You can see a patient is having a incision in the lower abdomen like this, and this breast is getting reconstructed like this, and probably this patient had some flap shifted here like this. So this is a post mastectomy patient had tram flap for breast reconstruction. So this is a tram flap, transverse rectus abdominis myocutaneous flap. Transverse rectus abdominis myocutaneous flap. Okay, so please don't forget, transverse rectus abdominis myocutaneous flap. So PMMC is pectoralis major myocutaneous flap used for oral cancer reconstruction. PMMC is pectoralis major myocutaneous flap. It is used for oral cancer reconstruction. So Vasanta Jagajeevan is asking, what is the best flap? Now the latest best flap for breast reconstruction is DIEP flap. Please remember, DIEP is the latest flap used for breast, which is deep inferior epigastric perforator flap. deep inferior epigastric perforator flap. But for your exams, they will ask you only this tram flap. Please don't forget tram flap. It can even come as a one-liner. Tram flap is used in breast reconstruction after mastectomy. Don't forget this. So tram flap is based on superior epigastric artery or inferior epigastric artery. There are two arteries which will supply this. Superior, inferior, superior and inferior, two arteries are there. So it can be on any one of these arteries. So if you use a pedicled flap, it is superior epigastric artery. If you use a free flap, it is inferior epigastric artery. There are two types of tram flap, pedicle and free. Pedicle and free, two types of flaps are available. Okay, tram flap. So that's about the head and neck, thyroid, breast. We'll go to the GIT session, and I hope you all would have seen all these barium images. I'm going to put lines one by one, whichever we discussed on that day. So now let me come to the 39th question. Barium swallow, what is your diagnosis? Can you tell me what is the diagnosis on this barium swallow? What is the diagnosis on this barium swallow? It is a typical, this is a bird's beak deformity. This is a bird's beak. I don't know why some of you are answering as C. This is a typical bird's beak, like a bird hanging down from a tree. This is a typical achalasia cardia, no doubt. Okay, achalasia cardia. There is an abrupt cutoff of contrast. You can see the abrupt cutoff of contrast. No contrast coming down from that cutoff point. That is a constriction. Some of you have told in that previous question as diffuse esophageal spasm. This is a barium swallow showing you diffuse esophageal spasm. What finding is this? What is this? This is what we say as corkscrew esophagus. I'm seeing many wrong answers in the chat box. Please never ever make mistake in these type of questions. Corkscrew esophagus is for diffuse esophageal spasm. Please don't make mistakes. So I'm just putting the, in GIT, I'm just putting the direct images from GIT. So what is the diagnosis? This is a picture of barium enema. What is your diagnosis in this barium enema? In a barium enema, you are seeing what appearance? Can you tell me what is this appearance you are seeing here? Please tell the appearance. It is known as, you should tell the appearance and then diagnosis. It is known as sawtooth appearance. Very good, Joshna. It is sawtooth, Jayshree, Sushant. Very good. It is seen in sigmoid diverticulum. Sigmoid diverticulosis, actually multiple diverticulum will cause this. Sigmoid diverticulosis will cause this sawtooth appearance. Very good. And some of you would have known what is this appearance in a barium enema. You can see this classically. What is the name of this appearance and what is your diagnosis? Tell me like that. This is a normal apple. No, if you have eaten the apple on the side, the apple remaining will be like this. So this is known as apple core or eaten apple, as you are telling, apple eaten. So this is apple core appearance seen here, typical of cancer colon. You should never make mistake again in this question. So very good. Most of you have answered it correctly. And this is a classical new question. This is again a barium enema in which you are looking like a sawtooth, but it is not sawtooth. It is a, you can see this part is splenic flexure. This part is splenic flexure. So which disease is common in the splenic flexure? Ischemic colitis. What appearance is this? What is the appearance of ischemic colitis on barium enema? No, not caterpillar tram tag. What is this? It is a thumbprint appearance. You can see if I keep my thumb on the bowel everywhere. So classical multiple thumbprint, keeping my thumb here, my thumb here, my thumb here. This is known as thumbprint appearance in ischemic colitis. So please don't forget, this is thumbprint appearance in ischemic colitis. Please don't forget this question also. I yield for your exams. Ischemic colitis. I hope you will answer this by seeing the moment you see this. This is a bent inner tube appearance on a plain X-ray. This is known as what appearance? What is the name of the appearance? It is coffee bean or bent inner tube appearance. Bent inner tube or coffee bean appearance. Typical feature of sigmoid volvulus. Very good. Many of you are correct. Joshna, Vasanta, everyone. Perfect. It is sigmoid volvulus. These are all direct picture-based questions. So I hope you will understand this is again an FMG question already asked in the exam. This is just looking like the picture. You can see it's a newborn baby. It is a newborn baby. They have kept a coin, 1 rupee coin at the level of anus. And this is a classical image known as invertogram. And the ideal answer, there is a controversy, but correct answer is it should be done after 24 hours of childbirth. After 24 hours of childbirth, when there is no anus found, please remember, when there is no anus found, we keep a 1 rupee coin and take an x-ray. This is an imperforate anus. So very simple question, imperforate anus, invertogram. Invertogram, the contrast is the baby swallowed gas comes to the final part of the bowel in 24 hours. That is the contrast used. No contrast is used. Baby's swallowed gas act as a contrast. So you should not think invertogram means some contrast would have been given. It is not like that. It is a baby's swallowed gas coming there. Okay. So coming to the hepatobiliary pancreas. This question has come 2 times in FMG exam itself as some different, not as an image-based question, but as a theory question also it has come. Can you tell me what is the answer here? Name the anomaly shown here. Name the anomaly shown here. From the picture you can see, the right hepatic artery is making a tortuous course and coming to the Calotte's triangle. So right hepatic artery is making a tortuous course and coming to the into the Calotte's triangle. What is the answer? None of you have answered it correctly. But this is a question directly taken from Bailey and Love, and this question has been asked many times in your FMG exam. Please don't make mistake. This is known as caterpillar turn or Moynihan's hump. Yes, now some of you are answering it correctly. Kotishwar Reddy, Mohammed Shan, Tanvir, everyone answered correctly. This is known as caterpillar turn. Please don't forget this. Caterpillar turn or Moynihan's hump. So what happens here? The right hepatic artery, instead of going like this, right hepatic artery, this is left hepatic artery. This guy takes a tortuous course like this and comes to the Calotte's triangle before going. This is a picture directly from Bailey and Love. Please don't forget it is Moynihan hump, and this is not double cystic duct. In the picture, watch closely, there is only one cystic duct given. I have not made double cystic duct in this image. This image you will answer if you see the Bailey, the moment, the first picture in hepatobiliary surgery in Bailey and Love is this. So please don't make mistake in this Moynihan's hump. Moynihan's hump is an anomaly of right hepatic artery. As some of you asked me, sir, how to differentiate ERCP and MRCP on that day? Some of you guys asked me. So in this picture, if you see, there is no endoscopy seen. If you see, I told you, no endoscopy in a case of ERCP, you can see an endoscopy here, that through that endoscopy, the contrast would have been pushed. But here you can see it is not a ERCP. This is a picture of MRCP, and that is showing you a cutoff sign here in this picture. You can see from that, there is a cutoff shown here. What is the name of that cutoff? Can you see there is a cutoff? That cutoff looks like what appearance? What is the appearance of that cutoff? That cutoff is known as like this. It is looking like this. Sorry, I'm changing the color. This is a cutoff sign. What is the name of this sign? Please tell me the name of the sign. I'm not only discussing the images alone here. I want to discuss the name of the sign. So this is a stone. Even a baby will tell there is a stone. That is not a doubt. Even a small baby, first year MBA student will tell it. Very good. Very good. Smile. That is Tanvir. That is known as crescent sign. Crescent sign is seen in the bile duct in CBD stone. That is crescent sign or meniscus sign. That's perfect. Rajeshwaran is more perfect. Many of us will tell it as meniscus sign. We call this as meniscus, like a meniscus sign. So meniscus or a crescent shine in the CBD is seen in CBD stone. Stone causes this sign. Please don't forget this meniscus sign. The moment you see this patient, you will be thinking he is doing a namas prayer. But it is not due to prayer. He is having intolerable pain. What is the name of this sign? So always image should be discussed with that sign. What is the name of this sign? Yes, all of you are correct. Everyone is correct. It is pancreatitis. What is the name of the sign? This sign is known as Mohammedan prayer sign. Mohammedan prayer sign. Like a Muslim doing namaz, these guys will be sitting with the bent forward in the ward when you go inside. Severe pain, severe pancreatic pain makes them sit like this. This is Mohammedan prayer sign for acute severe pancreatitis. Acute pancreatitis. Okay. This is a direct picture again. Very important from Bailey and Love. So again, I hope you will be knowing this already. Last in our discussion itself, you told the answer for this. What is the name of this sign? Pigmentation around the umbilicus. What is the name of this sign? It is known as In acute hemorrhagic pancreatitis, we get this sign known as Kulan sign. That is known as Kulan sign. Okay, Kulan sign. So I hope you all know that very well. It's a Kulan sign. All of you are correct. Very good. So the other same sign on the line is known as Great Dana sign. If you get this here, it is known as If you get it here, it is known as Great Dana sign. And if you get it in the inguinal region, it is known as Fox sign. So Great Dana, Fox, and Kulan are the three important signs you should not forget. Fox is inguinal ecchymosis. So what is the name of this tube? You should tell me what is the name of the tube and then the diagnosis. What is the name of this tube? This is a typical Singh-Stecken Blackmore tube. This tube is known as Singh-Stecken Blackmore tube. So what is the use of this tube? Can you tell me Singh-Stecken Blackmore tube? What is the use? Yes, what is the name? What is the use of this tube? Are you getting me? Yeah, most of you have answered it correctly. It is esophageal varices. Let me show you some important description about this tube. So this is a tube in those days, especially when I am doing my MBBS, these tubes are very commonly available. Nowadays, this tube is outdated. Nobody have seen this tube also now. Presently, I have also not seen this tube for more than 5 years. So this is known as Singh-Stecken Blackmore tube. So now what we are having is modified Singh-Stecken Blackmore tube. So please see the tube. The tube will be made up of rubber. It has two balloons. This is one balloon and this is one another balloon. Okay. And it is having four lumen. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. We have four lumens. So the one lumen is used to inflate esophageal balloon. Another is to inflate gastric balloon. So what we do in this, another is to aspirate from the esophagus. Another is to aspirate from the stomach. So the main purpose is we put this tube into the GIT like this. So this gastric balloon will be first inflated and then second we will inflate the esophageal balloon and we will cause compression of the esophageal varices. This is a temporary procedure only, not a treatment of choice. We compress the esophageal varices and refer the patient to a medical gastroenterologist for the definitive treatment of varices, that is endoscopic banding. Then we refer them to a banding. So this is a tube used in those days. Nowadays, this tube is outdated and not at all available in the community. It may only come as FMG exams, okay? Please don't forget. So, but this question is there in Bailey and Love, and this question is a very favorite question for old examiners. In FMG exam, no, most of your examiners will be very old fellows. So they may ask you this. So please remember this, okay? So this is not Minnesota tube. This is a Singh-Stecken Blackmore tube. Minnesota tube and all is totally outdated. So don't worry about those tubes. Remember this tube alone. It is there in Bailey and Love. Okay. There are many tubes, Linton, Minnesota, like that. Old tubes are there. None of them you can see in the market. You cannot even buy if you even want to buy. So just remember these names. Okay. Yes, old fellows, they will be always asking the old questions and they will be irritating you. No other option. You have to remember at least for your exams. What is the use of this instrument? I hope you know the answer for this. What is the name of this instrument? What is very good? It is Humby's knife. Very good. It is Humby's knife. It is known as Humby's knife. Humby knife. Humby knife. It is used to harvest Thiersch graft. I hope you know what is Thiersch graft. Don't make mistakes in Thiersch graft at all. You should keep on remembering them. Thiersch graft is partial thickness graft. Wolf graft is full thickness graft. This Thiersch graft, partial thickness graft can be taken by this knife known as Humby's knife. So here there is an interesting picture. Cut injury of the hand. The hand is cut and it is, maybe some would have come with a knife and this guy has holded the knife, the hand is cut. Now you are going to do reconstruction of the structures. What is the order of reconstruction? Which one will you do first? That is the question. The order of reconstruction, please remember the mnemonic B fans. Remember the mnemonic B fans. B for bone. E for extensor tendon. F for flexor tendon. A for artery and vein. Both together. Artery first, vein next. Then comes nerve and the last one is skin. This is the order of reconstruction. order of reconstruction of the structures are B fans. Bone, extensor tendon, flexor, extensor tendon and extensor muscle, flexor tendon and flexor muscles, artery with vein, nerve, finally the last one is skin. Please don't make mistake in this. This is B fans. So I hope you can see, from the moment you see the image, you can say what is this case. So what is your diagnosis on seeing this baby? So you can see the baby, entire bowel is lying outside. The bowel is lying outside and it is angry looking bowel. Bowel is lying outside and it is angry looking. What is this diagnosis? This is a gastroschisis. Very good. So this is gastroschisis. All other three are same. Actually, all other three are same. Examphalos, major is more than 5 cm. Minor is less than 1 cm and ampullocele. All these guys are same. The only point is they have a covering membrane. These guys have a covering membrane. In gastroschisis, there is no covering membrane. The bowel is exposed to the atmosphere. It is angry looking bowel. Okay. So answer here is D. So this is a really tough question for you, but I didn't keep the question as an image based question. I want you to know this appearance. I want you to remember this appearance. So please see this appearance in this kidney. So this is a kidney. If you want a clue, this is the kidney of the patient. You can see the kidney of the patient. It is polycystic kidney disease. The kidney is full of cyst. And for him, when I do an IVP, I am getting this appearance. What is the name of this appearance? I have put this question not to know the diagnosis, because I have already told the diagnosis. It is seen in polycystic kidney disease. FMG question. In polycystic kidney disease, what is appearance seen? Very good. Jayashree has answered it correctly. It is spider leg appearance. From the image, you can see it is spider leg. Horseshoe kidney will have flower vase. Please don't forget. Let me tell you some appearances here. This is spider leg appearance on IVP. Please don't make mistake in this. Let me tell you some appearances in the kidney, which is asked in the exam. So please don't make mistake in these appearances. Flower vase appearance. Like a flower vase. Like this, like a flower vase appearance is seen in horseshoe kidney. And in this picture, what you are seeing is spider leg like this, spider leg appearance. It is seen in polycystic kidney disease. Some of you have answered as drooping lily appearance. Nice. Drooping lily appearance. Drooping lily is like this. The lily will be drooping downwards. All these are IVP findings. On an IVP, drooping lily appearance is seen in ectopic ureter. Ectopic ureter. So please don't forget these three names, because these three names can come as one-liners. Flower vase appearance, horseshoe kidney, spider leg in polycystic, drooping lily in ectopic ureter, and cobra head appearance on cystoscopy, like a cobra head on a cystoscopy. Where will you get it? Cobra head on a cystoscopy is seen in diverticulum, uretrocele. Seen in uretric diverticulum known as uretrocele. I hope you know what is golf hole ureter. Where is it seen? Golf hole ureter and a thimble bladder. Golf hole ureter and a thimble bladder are seen in TB. Golf hole ureter, thimble bladder are seen in TB of urinary system. So these are all some funny names. You should have remember these funny names, because the examiners may be asking all these things. So please don't forget these points. Okay, don't forget these points. Just I have made just a few only. I have made. I don't know how to zoom it. So can you see it? Flower vase appearance, horseshoe, spider leg appearance, polycystic kidney disease, drooping lily is ectopic ureter, uretrocele cystoscopy. Golf hole ureter is TB and thimble bladder is TB. Okay, please don't forget these points. Okay. I will try to share this video. Don't worry, Shravan. So this is a picture showing you spider leg appearance. No doubt in that. Okay. So I hope you remember the image from this picture. Can you see this picture? What is this appearance? From the moment you see this, you can tell. I just now told you this is looking like a cobra head appearance. You can see the cobra head appearance on an IVP. Also, you can get this cobra head appearance on cystoscopy. Also, you can see that it is a cobra head appearance seen in uretrocele. just now I told you it is erythrocele. Erythrocele. Okay. So some of you told flower vase appearance. No, here is that flower vase appearance in horseshoe kidney. In horseshoe kidney, you can see the typical flower vase appearance. See the flower vase appearance in horseshoe kidney. So classical question. Penis is seen on X-ray. You can see the penis seen on X-ray. Calcified penis with a painful erection. Where do you get this? Calcified penis with a painful erection. No, not in priapism. In priapism, we don't see the penis as a calcified. There are two diseases in erection. One is priapism, another is peyronie's. In priapism, there will be painful erection, but it is not seen on X-ray and all. It is peyronie's disease. Peyronie's disease. Priapism is a vascular disorder, whereas peyronie's is a fibrosing disease. Fibrosing disease of the penis. The penis becomes fibrosed and looks like a calcified, hard bone-like. Okay. We have to do one surgery for them to make the penis straight. That is Nesbitt operation. Nesbitt operation is done for these type of Peyronie's disease. Peyronie's disease, we do Nesbitt operation. But this question is classical image-based question. Penis seen on X-ray. Please don't make mistake. And this question is being many times asked in NEET PG exam, and you can definitely get this question. Duplex ultrasound of left sphenofemoral junction is shown here. And on duplex ultrasound, what is this image seen? This is a classical Mickey Mouse sign. The question is not asking Mickey Mouse. They're asking false statement. This is actually self-made question. I'm not asking which is true here. The sign is Mickey Mouse sign. That is correct. That is a Mickey Mouse. You can see this is a Mickey Mouse. The Mickey Mouse, the face is femoral vein. Medially, we have long saphenous vein. Laterally, you have femoral artery. So femoral vein, long saphenous vein, and femoral artery appear like a Mickey Mouse. So it is not known as saphenous eye. So answer false statement is A, not T. Okay. So answer here is, so actually I have made the mistake. I have made it as false statement. Answer is A. Please change the answer. It is false statement is A. The picture is showing you Mickey Mouse sign. So the right side of the ear here is, the right side here is saphenous vein, that is correct. This is femoral artery, and this is face is femoral vein. So please remember, nothing else you need to remember here. In this, you should remember this is Mickey Mouse sign. Mickey Mouse sign contains three structures: long saphenous vein, femoral vein, and femoral artery. Remember that point alone. Okay. So what is the name of this catheter? This question has come in FMJ exam, so that's why I put this question. So this is used for removal of thrombus, thrombectomy. Vascular surgery instrument by interventional radiologists. No, they pass this and they will remove the thrombus using this. Very good, Jayashree. Very good. All of you, Ashok, Joshna, that's Fogarty catheter. That is known as Fogarty catheter. That's perfect. That is Fogarty catheter. It's perfect. It is Fogarty catheter. So biopsy from a skin cancer has been done, and that is showing you a keratin pearl. This is known as onion skin appearance or keratin pearl. So where will you get keratin pearl appearance? Can you tell me where will you get keratin pearl appearance? Keratin pearl on biopsy is a feature of squamous cell cancer, not from in basal cell cancer. There is peripheral palisading of cells. In basal cell cancer, there is peripheral palisading of cells, but in squamous cell cancer, there is keratin pearl appearance. This is a picture showing you keratin pearl. It's a pathology MCQ. It's a pathology MCQ. Please don't forget, this is keratin pearl appearance seen in squamous cell cancer. So that completes the 60 MCQs. Please go through this MCQ. I will share these 4 points. You keep on using these questions for your exams. Okay. I hope you are understanding the MCQs. So any other doubt, you can please tell me. Any other doubt you have, please tell me. I will share these 2 PDF which we discussed on that day, and today I will share these 2. I'll share them. Don't worry. Any other doubt? Yeah, video is possible to be shared. I will share it, or I will upload it in my YouTube channel. I don't know whether it is possible to be shared or not. There are some question and answers from some of you. So some of them are asked. Some of them have posted the answer in the question and answer discussion. So we don't see the question and answer. You have to post in the chat. So you can expect at least some 40 to 50 IB questions. But actually the IBQ I am discussing mainly because not because they are all image based question. But because I want you to understand one-liners based on this. Some one-liners you can get from image-based question. That's why we discuss this IBQs. I'm sharing you the questions. Don't worry. Those who came late, you can use the video. I'm going to share the video also. That's why I recorded the video, since some people are less. So don't worry. So please keep revising. The dates are announced. So FMG exam, they don't want you to know in depth and all. Just know what is being practiced superficially. You can easily pass out. So once for passing, you need to know only the basics. So please remember the basics. I'll try to share the. I will now share the PDF in my Telegram group. Please download in that. Rapid revision video is available in my app for those who have already subscribed the app. It is there. Actually, it is available there. I will share it. Or you can see my YouTube channel. There are many many YouTube videos are there. Kodeshwar Reddy, thank you, because I am unable to come for the class. Actually, I had to come for 4 days class to RIS Academy, but due to this COVID issues, we are unable to come for that. So the main tip for your exam is, Mohammed Shan, you have to read, revise again and again. Don't try to read so many points. Just read only the repeat questions. Keep on reading the repeat questions. Definitely you will answer most of the questions. I have recorded this video. I will share it. Don't worry. I'm going to try share it. Thank you, Hemant. Thank you, all of you. Nice meeting you all. We'll try to see if by chance the corona issues, I don't think will be over before your exam. So I think I am unable to come for your classes this time. So we'll meet you all in your PG preparation. Thank you, guys. Bye. So antibiotic prophylaxis, Vasanth Jigan, is given at 1 hour before surgery only. It's given 1 hour before skin incision. So in nutcracker, the amplitude will be 400 millimeters mercury. 400 millimeters mercury. Now they have renamed that value 8000 millimeters mercury centimeters seconds. Kotishwar Reddy, they have now named as 8000 millimeters mercury centimeters second. Thank you, Mohammed Shah. Here is same. Everything is same. Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, it is same. Same type of cases. But in my place, the case number is less. I'm in a periphery, not in Chennai. So here it is less. Thank you all, guys. See you soon. Bye. Take care.